First of all, thank you all to be here. I'm Francesco Bodria, a user community activist of social impact of AI and explainable AI, exploratory of Subic Data Platform, plus platform. Today we have a webinar on the Subic Data Exploratory on explainable AI and social impact of AI. The speaker for today is Riccardo Guidotti, a researcher at the University of Pisa. He is currently working with the research group of Explainable AI. This research group, which I'm part of, is led by Fosca Giannotti with the European ERC grant. Riccardo is one of the most active people in our group, has published several works in the topic of Explainable AI, and today we'll talk us about explaining explanation methods. So without further delays, I give the floor to you, Riccardo.
Thank you, Francesco, for the introduction. And hello, everyone. So today, I'll give you a very broad overview on explanations and explanation methods. And this webinar will consist in two parts. In the first part, I will show you this overview, illustrating first which are the motivations for explainable AI, the main problems, and a categorization of the most widely adopted notions of explanations. And then in the second part, we will see an hands-on tutorial with a Python notebook using libraries which are available online and also available on the Subic Data Platform. So let's start with the first part, with problems in explainability and explanation methods. And I want to start from the beginning, from the definitions, because in explainable AI, there are two verbs or nouns which are widely used. The first one is to interpret, that from the dictionary means to give or provide the meaning or to explain and present in understandable terms some concept. In the AI, this verb, interpret, is referred with a strong reference to human. So it's the ability to explain and to provide the meaning in understandable terms to a human, indicating that the notions, the knowledge that have to be passed from one part to the other is going from a machine, from something that is automatic, an artificial intelligence system, to a human. And the other verb used here is to explain, and in explainable AI, these two terms are quite interchangeable. I will use more the term explain and explanations, but they are quite synonyms. Then after having presented to you some concept, I'll give you the main meaning assumed in the literature by these two terms. But what we want to explain? We want to explain black box models. And a black box model is a system, is something that as human we cannot understand, either because we cannot access the internals of the decision process, because maybe it's a proprietary software or we have no access practically to it, or even though we can access to the internals, the following the reasoning from the input to the output is very complicated for humans. We cannot really follow all the whole stream of decisions taken by the machine for returning the final outcome. Examples of these are obviously deep neural networks, but also SVM or ensemble methods like random forest, where generally these are systems quite complex, involving different parts for taking the final decision. On the other hand, we have those which are referred as interpretable models or transparent models. And they arrive to us from the beginning of machine learning. So we have decision trees. We have decision rules that can be derived from decision trees or decision rules extracted with some other techniques, but also the coefficients of linear models. And these are generally referred to as features importance, because for instance, in this example, we can see the positive and negative contribution that every feature has on the final outcome. In this case, is the survival on the well-known Titanic dataset. And here we have interpretable. This is because generally we refer to interpretable machine learning models to models which are interpretable by design, while explainability is much more used when we want to explain a black box system. So this is the main usage in the literature, but as I said, they are quite interchangeable. Which are the main motivations for explaining these methods? Well, there are various reasons. One that is quite interesting is obviously the bias that could be hidden in the data or in the training process or in the algorithmic procedure used. This example is very famous. It's the COMPASS, it's referred to the COMPASS score. That is a score for predicting the risk of crime recidivism used by some US courts. And it's also used to decide if people in jail is worth to have some more level of freedoms. And an agency in US, the ProPublica company, discovered that this score was obtained, was biased basically, because was basically providing high risk scores to black people, even though the let's say the history of prior offenses or general offenses of white people was much worse than those of black people's. And this only because there was a bias in the data set used for training the model learning this score. Another well-known example that is quite easy to understand is the one of the wolf and the snow, and it's a background bias. Indeed, in this experiment, there was deep neural networks well trained to recognize husky dogs from wolves. And this is quite difficult even for humans because these two animals are quite similar. But the machine was very effective, very good. Then an explanation method that I'll present later was used because in the test set, the machine was not performing as expected. For instance, here we have an husky dog classified as a wolf. And this explanation, revealing the part of the image in which the deep neural network posed the attention in returning the classification, discovered that was the background, in particular the snow in the background, in revealing that in the picture there is a wolf, because if we go back and we carefully check the data set, we can observe that all the wolves in the training set, this is a sample obviously, are depicted with snow in the background, while husky dogs are depicted in springtime or in other environments, and they never have snow in the background. So explanations techniques can be used to find such biases, but also can be used to check if the classifier is fair or if it's, let's say, guaranteeing the privacy of the users, can be used for debugging purposes to check that the behavior is what is expected by the data scientists, various reasons, depending on who is the final user, obviously. It's important to say that explanation in the last years is becoming ubiquitous in many different fields of AI, obviously starting from machine learning, that is the main topic of this presentation, but there is also a strong component in computer vision, in knowledge representation and reasoning, multi-agent systems, natural language processing, obviously, planning and scheduling, and robotics. Which is the final aim, at least to our extent, the belief of our research group is that the final extent of explanation is a sort of machine-human conversation in which a user can interact to the classifier and check why there is a certain outcome returned by the classifier. So for instance, in this picture, we have a fish correctly classified by the machine learning model, but the human can have doubts and ask, why do you see a fish in this picture? Then this can be a first kind of explanation, still highlighting the important parts, important areas pushing the classification towards a class rather than towards another one. For instance, in this example, the green areas are pushing the classification towards fish, while the red ones are pushing the classification towards dog. But as a human, we can see that indeed the fish is not covered by green regions. And so you can ask the machine to provide some other examples which are influential for the prediction. And the machine can reply with these two prototypical examples, getting the same label of the original image and having a similar score. So you can start to guess that, like in the example of the wolf and the snow, there is a sort of bias in this classification because this kind of fish lives in this anemone, and therefore the classifier can be biased and not recognizing the fish itself, but rather recognizing the anemone in the background, because either the first explanation with the super pixel and the second one having these examples are depicting fish with anemone in the background. So you can furtherly ask to the system, can you try to remove the background and try to classify again and explain again the new picture? And the machine this time highlights in green the fish and still correctly classify the image as a fish. Then now as a human, you can start to trust the machine that is able to recognize a fish, or maybe not, because you have some fatherly doubt. The point here is that enabling a sort of machine-human conversation is maybe the final trick to start to have a complete trust between human and machine, and having human completely trusting AI systems. As I was mentioning earlier, there is an important thing to consider in explanation. The question is not if is the explanation interpretable, but to whom is the explanation interpretable, because there are not universally interpretable explanations. And this highly depends on the final user of the explanation. In the literature are mainly recognized three kinds of users. We have end users, which are those, let's say, that on which the final decision act or that observe the final decision as a final subject. For instance, you go to a bank and ask for a loan, and your loan is rejected, you want an explanation. In this case, you want to know what you could have done in order to get the loan, which are different conditions that you should have posed. But another important role is the one of the engineers developing the classification system, the decision system, or of the data scientist. that can check if the system is working as expected, to check if the system is biased, if it's fair, if it's maintaining privacy. And finally, we also have regulators that can exploit explanations to check if the system is compliant with the actual rules. Because 2 years ago, with the latest GDPR, we have explanation as a requirement for all the automatic decision system taking decision involving humans. So an ideal explainer should meet the user background. I want to add also that another important aspect is the time that the final user has to understand the explanation, because in critical condition, maybe the explanation can be less accurate, but must be very easy to interpret and fast to read. And this connects us to this important point highlighted by Tim Miller in his paper about the social aspect of explainable AI, that explainable AI is interdisciplinary, and it lies at the crossroads between artificial intelligence, social science, and human-computer interaction. And only when we will be able to deal with all these aspects together, we will really be able to open the black box and understand how these systems are working from a human perspective. So now let's go a bit more into the details and see a classification of the existing techniques and the on the explanation method, starting from the problems. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm mainly referring to the classification problem. This is a simplified workflow illustrating how we learn a black box from a training set. We apply it on the test set to get a prediction. So our aim is to explain this prediction. Well, in the literature, we recognize these different problems. On one hand, we have the transparent box design, while on the other hand, we have the black box explanation. With respect to the transparent box design or explanation by design, also referred to as intrinsic interpretability, the final aim is to replace the current black box systems adopted with a completely transparent system where together with the explanation, together with the prediction, we also have the explanation. And obviously this is quite challenging because generally systems like deep neural networks are quite effective, relying on high performance that cannot be reached by transparent systems. And thus the transparency is paid with a lower level of performance. And in addition, this kind of technique cannot be applied in every problem setting because it also depends on the data type. However, to summarize and schematize it, the idea is to replace the black box learner and the black box predictor with an interpretable learner and interpretable predictor. I mean, the only important thing is that the predictor is interpretable, such that when I have a test instance or a set of test instances, I can extract the reasons for the explanations. For instance, using a set of rules or a decision tree or the feature importance. On the other hand of the problem, we have the black box explanation. And this time the idea is to replace, to pair with the black box AI system an explanation subsystem that works in parallel and together with the black box. And for every prediction or for all the prediction is able to retrieve an explanation. In particular, in the literature, we differentiated between three problems solved. The one is the model explanation, the second is the outcome explanation, and the third one is the model inspection. In the model explanation setting, the idea is to have an explanation capturing the overall logic of the black box. So what we are aiming to design is an interpretable global predictor that is able to capture the whole behavior of the black box. Like in this example, I'm able to explain any possible decision taken by the black box by using this list of rules. This problem was mainly treated when we had the first development of neural networks in the late 90s, trying to explain neural networks. We will see some examples later. Obviously, these approaches are difficult to design for images and text and work better on tabular data, tabular data where we have a clear structure and it's easier, let's say, to differentiate the behavior, the overall behavior of the machine. On the other hand, in the last year, the research on XI is focusing more on the outcome explanation problem, where the idea is to provide the explanation for a unique specific instance we are interested to explain. So we have the black box that is classifying X as 0, 1, or yes or no. And what I want to do is to build an interpretable local predictor that is able to explain the reason only for this specific instance. Here in this example, we can see a rule explaining the reason why this instance is classified as yes. The idea introduced in 2016, mainly with the paper of Ribeiro et al., is that even though the overall decision boundary can be complex, like this one highlighted by the blue and pink areas in the picture, in the neighborhood of a single instance, like the red cross, it can be easy to distinguish the decision boundary and approximate it with a local decision boundary, which is easier to learn and to finally communicate to the user. In this example, the decision boundary is approximated by this gray dashed line that only separates between the two regions close to the red point. Finally, the third kind of problem is, let's say, in between the two previous one, and is not aimed at finding a global or a local explanation, but it's more aimed at returning a system for respecting the behavior of the black box through a visual representation. For instance, I want to observe the weight of a certain set of neurons of a deep neural network and observe how it varies while varying a feature, or observing the prediction probability for a certain class while varying a combination of features. In any one of these cases, these last three cases presented, those for black box explanation, the explanation strategy is based on the so-called reverse engineering paradigm. And this name comes from the fact that what we want to do is to only observe the input and the output of the black box. And so the possible actions we can do is to change the input with random perturbation, with smart perturbations, and observe the output by exploiting an interpretable model adapting a model rather than another one. Without accessing or just partially accessing the internals of the bots. And this further aspect, that is accessing the internals or not of the black box, provides a further categorization of explanation methods. That is, if they are generalizable or not, that is traduced in the literature as being model agnostic or model specific. A model agnostic interpreter does not require to access the internal of the black box and therefore can be used to explain any type of black box model. It can be a deep neural network, a strange type of convolutional neural network, an ensemble of methods, a composition of software. You just need to access to the function returning the classification, the decision, because the learner is independent from the black box. So you act on random perturbation, you observe the prediction, and you build the interpretable learner on the so-called oracle, which are the prediction of the black box on the perturbation. And finally, you extract the interpretable predictor. On the other hand, an explainer is said to be model specific if the interpretable learner is strictly dependent on the black box and need to access internals of the black box to retrieve the final explanation. For instance, if we want to explain a random forest classifier and we want to base our interpretable learner on operations we perform on the decision trees composing the random forest, then in this case, we deal with a model specific explainer. The same if we use a composition of operation among layers of a deep neural network, we can only explain a deep neural network. And so this is a model specific explainer. Finally, before passing to details on methods and explanation, I want to highlight which are the main types of data studied in explainable AI. Obviously, we have tabular data from the first studies. Then the great majority of work is focusing on images and image classifiers. But in the last years, we have a consistent amount of work also with respect to classifiers working on text. Finally, we have also some preliminary studies with other type of data like time series, sequences, graphs, genomic sequences, etc. But these are just a small minority. This is why if you look for surveys on explainable AI, you will find the works mainly focusing on these three types of data. So let's start with illustrating some explanations and explanation method. I start with list of rules. So the final explanation is returned as a list of conditions in ends. Obviously, this type of explanation only applies for tabular data. And in this case, I'm presenting to you Corels, which is a transparent by design system. So here the idea is to replace the black box with a directly interpretable system. This system is proposed by Cynthia Rudin and the other. The idea of Cynthia Rudin is to push a lot for transparency in developing new algorithm, exactly to stay for the explainability by design of the novel algorithms adopted by AI system. And in this case, the algorithm adopts a branch and bound strategy to find an optimal solution, which is also compact. by pruning away incomplete rule lists which have a low coverage or a low precision. This algorithm also returns a certificate of optimality for the rule list returned. And here you can see an example for the exactly for the Compass dataset, if I'm not wrong, in saying if it has or not a high risk of recidivism. Another explainer returning a list of rules is RxRen. This system was designed in 2012 for explaining deep neural networks, in particular for tabular data. And this is a model-specific approach because it acts on the network, so starts by pruning insignificant neurons, and then for the remaining neurons, for every outcome of the black box, computes the data ranges in which the features and the internal weights of the on the network acts, and build rules from these ranges, finding the condition leading from the input to the output, encoding it into rules. Then tries to prune insignificant rules and tries to update the rules by expressing the condition with respect to the input such that the list of rules is more interpretable. Obviously, the limitation of this is that can be applied only to this kind of network working on tabular data, and maybe the rule list is not easy to read for someone who is different from the one who designed the network. The Trepan method is one of the first proposal for explainable AI, presented by Craven in 1996, is initially meant to explain neural network, but it is actually model agnostic, as it doesn't refer to any specific model for extracting the explanation. So in this case, the idea is to approximate the behavior of a black box model with a single decision tree, and therefore the task is to reconstruct a decision tree based on the outcome on the label returned by the black box instead of on the real label. You can see highlighted in the pseudocode reported here the auditing of the black box that is performed not on the real data, but on this set Z that consists on an amplification of the real data that is done to maintain a high level of records adopted to test the behavior of the black box in the different splits while constructing the tree. Then, differently from classic decision tree, this particular type of tree is using rules adopting the best M of N splits. It means that just M out of N condition must be satisfied in order to guarantee the rule. So there is a sort of fuzziness in the construction of this tree. We move from a single tree approximation through a rule-based approximation together provided by Lore. Lore is a proposal from our lab. I'll show you later in the notebook how it works practically. But Lore works to explain a single instance, while on the other hand, Trepan provides the overall logic of the black box explained. Lore returns explanation only for a specific instance and generates a neighborhood around the instance, being in the outcome explanation problem by exploiting a genetic neighborhood approach, so using operations like crossover and mutation. And this helps Lorin staying close to the decision boundary and finding easily which are the records synthetically generated that are close to X, but make the label to be different for the black box. Here I highlighted by zeta, Z different. Once the neighborhood is generated, Lore adopts a local decision tree trained on this neighborhood to extract the final explanation, what is composed by a local factual rule highlighted in green and reported in the bottom of the slide. In this case, is age lower than 25, job equals to clerk, income lower than 900, then is denied for the loan request. But it also allows to extract counterfactual rules highlighted in purple, which are minimal because returns consist in the minimum number of changes according to the tree learned, and make to change the class for the classification. So this is a factual and counterfactual rule-based explanation returned by Lore. Still staying in the outcome explanation problem and therefore a local explainer, here we have LIME, one of the first method presented. LIME works quite in a similar way with respect to Lore, but on one hand, while Lore is designed to work on tabular data, LIME can be theoretically applied to any type of data, so tabular data, images, and text. And indeed requires this function that turn an instance from a real to an interpretable domain, where an interpretable domain can be, for instance, a set of superpixels for image, that is areas with the same color. Then randomly generates neighborhood in this interpretable domain, saying this superpixel is contained or not contained, or this word is contained or not contained, or assigning mean values for the tabular data, and generates a neighborhood that uses to train a lasso linear regressor, where the probabilities for obtaining a certain class returned by the black box auditing highlighted in the slide, and basically learns this lasso classifier, and finally the coefficients of the classifier are used as feature importances for the explanation. So in the picture, you can see that we have a cat in the picture because of the green areas highlighted. And we don't have a cat because of the red areas highlighted. Sharp has somehow a similar meaning. I'm not going to the detail. It's using the Shapley values to calculate the feature importance. So it's still a local model agnostic explanation method. But instead of using this technique based on training a surrogate model, is basically generating a neighborhood, generating alternatives in terms of combination of the features with respect to instance to explain, and tries to and measures the importance of the values using the Shapley values. Measure the importance of the features, sorry, using the Shapley values that still provides how much is important a feature for pushing the classification towards a certain outcome rather than a different one. We will see in detail an example later in the practical part. Moving to images and following the similarity with feature importance, we have the saliency maps are the most widely adopted technique for explanation. So a saliency map basically provides a map with pixels colored in a different way, signaling how much is important a certain pixel for the classification of that particular image. The literature, there are many works. The vast majority consist on model-specific approaches using backpropagation and perturbation-based approaches to retrieve the importance of these pixels. So therefore, we assist to a growing interest for model-specific approaches for obtaining this kind of explanation. Here I'm presenting one method proposed by Fong in 2017. And the idea is to find the saliency map by means of meaningful perturbation. So in this case, it's not using the gradient, but just perturbation on the input. And the idea is to find the smallest area R such that the classification for a given label, the probability of classification for a given label is minimized. In this example, we can see that flute is predicted with a probability of 0.99, while if I apply a blurring or a constant coverage of a certain area, like the one proposed in the second picture, the probability of predicting flute drops to 0.0007. And basically, the learned mask covering the flute basically corresponds to the explanation, corresponds to the saliency map. Finally, I conclude this overview showing an example of a method for model inspection named Prospector, that is again model agnostic. And basically the idea is to introduce random perturbations in the input and test the classifier, in particular the probability of obtaining a certain class by varying one variable at a time. So for instance, we make vary the variable age along all the distribution of the values, like in the example in the picture, and we observe if the black box answer is changing and which is the probability of obtaining a different class. So we can understand if and when there are changes in the performance. So the take-off message is that we should cooperate all together to open the black box, because there are still many things to do, especially for empowering the usage of AI system against undesired effect and reveal and protect new vulnerabilities, but also to be compliant with the law and implement the right of explanation, and particularly for business and companies to be compliant with the standards. In addition, we could help people in making better decisions, because these decisions are supported and shared with the machine, because the algorithms are aligned with human values, and this can help not only to preserve but also to expand the human autonomy. There are still many open research questions. First of all, there is not an agreement on what an explanation is, even though in the latest years we are coming to sort of summaries like those I have presented in this very broad overview. There is not for sure a formalism for defining explanation, And the most difficult things to do is to quantify the degree of comprehensibility of an explanation with respect to humans. So in the latest paper in this year, most of the work presenting new explanation methods are also completing the experiments with explanations involving humans that adopts explanation for complete a task, not only to say this explanation is better than this other one. Then going back to history would be good if it would be possible to join local explanations, which can be done almost on any kind of data, to build a global interpretable model. This is something we are also working on in our group, like which is the meaning of the latent features, latent dimensions adopted by the black boxes to return the final classification, specifically for deep neural networks. Another interesting question is that what happens if there is a cost for querying a black box? Because in all the works in the literature, we can, let's say, freely query. We have no cost for querying a black box, but if we cannot make so many prediction using the classifier and we have limited, maybe we have to change the strategy and optimize also for this aspect. So these are the references. So I would say thank you, and if it's okay, I can pass to the tutorial part, right?
So, Riccardo, you think it's a good moment for question or all the question after?
I don't know. It's the same for me. Maybe yes, if there are some, but on one hand, the practical part can help in answering some questions.
Okay, so maybe it's better at the end.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so, can you still see the screen?
For me, yes.
Okay, good. So here we have a notebook in which I'm going to present you three methods. Here I hope you are a bit familiar with Python, but I'm importing some libraries I'm going to use in the following. I want to focus more on the explanation. In this particular example, I will use the adult dataset, which is a well-known dataset. I designed a function prepare dataset. In particular, we are in the case of tabular data because we need to deal with missing values and categorical features and whatever, and have the dataset prepared to be used. So we have the dataset in a data frame like this. And this is the final version we are going to use both for the classifier and for the explanation. So as numerical features, we have age, capital gain, capital loss, hours per week. And then we have a set of categorical features which are one-hot encoded. And finally, we have the class. Here, I still maintain for visualization purposes the real data frame that is easier to read. And so we have work class, education, marital status, occupation, race, sex, native country, and the class is about designing a classifier that is able to understand if the overall income of someone is lower or higher than 50K. So as we know, we first of all split the data set into train and test, and we use the same splitting also for the real data frame because this is an information that is required from the explainers, and I call it K because it's the knowledge that is passed to the explainer. In particular, the explainers will use this portion of the data that is passed that corresponds to the same portion of the test set to learn the distribution of the data, because we are putting ourselves in the setting that the explainer doesn't know the portion of data used by the classifier. But depending on the application you use the explainer, you can also have access to it and you will have more accurate results. So in this case, we are explaining a random forest classifier. Here is the training of the classifier. Therefore, I have not normalized the data set. I use it as it is. What I have to do for every explanation method, at least from those presenting to you in this short tutorial, is to define two functions. The first one is the predict function that returns the final class. And in this case, it's easy to design, but maybe if you have normalization or particular operation with images, you can encapsulate everything you need here. While the second function is the predict proba function that returns the probability of obtaining each class. So it returns a list of lists. Here we have that the accuracy of our random forest is 0.84 and the F1 is 0.64. So it's not extraordinary, but it's more than enough for our purposes. So first of all, I select an instance I want to explain. In this case, is the instance with identifier 3, and I take it from the test set. Then I wrote this function record to string that provides a human readable version of the string, combining, let's say, the information of the feature names and the numeric columns, and running the one-hot encoding in the reverse way, such that is more compact. So we have someone of age 34, capital gain 0, capital loss 0, 40 hours per week, work class private, education bachelor's, marital status married, occupation prof, relationship husband, race white, sex male, and native country Iran. The classification of the method is lower than 50k. So this is again just an encoding for having a more nice string, but you can just read the BB outcome will be 0 in this case. So first explainer I'm presenting is Lime. Lime has three different import you can do depending on the type of data. So we have the tabular explainer, image explainer, and the text explainer. Here I'm showing only the tabular explainer. So you import the class Lime tabular explainer, then you instantiate the object, create a new object with type Lime tabular explainer, and you pass the knowledge, as I mentioned earlier. So Lime is not dealing with categorical and continuous variables, because you either consider all the variables categorical or all numerical, and the feature names, the class values, and in this case, indeed, I do not discretize continuous values, I keep them as they are. So in this case, I create the explainer, and then with this line of code, I explain the instance X using the predict probability function I've designed. As output, I get the explanation. Lime provides a facility to show it in notebook, that is this one. where it summarizes the results. So in this case, we have a probability of 0.5 and 0.5 for both classes. So the first one is taken. Indeed, none of the features here, we have the feature importance reported, is quite fundamental. In particular, we have that capital gain is pushing a bit towards the predicted class, zero minus than 50. And the same happens for married, and the same happened for age. In the last part, you can see the values of the variables describing this user. Okay, so we have a capital gain zero, age 34, the same we observed before. Obviously, you can also extract from a more, let's say, computer scientist approach the values of every feature, because you want to elaborate it on your own. And here you can find the same values. They are ordered in descending order. So this is the explanation returned by Lime. Then we have SHAP, that has also some building function for visualization using JavaScript. So it requires to call this command. The visualizations are not easy to understand, so it will take a while to explain them to you. So first of all, I already imported, okay, here I import SHAP, and I created this kind of explainer, which is the model agnostic explainer, named the kernel explainer. SHAP has also model specific explainer for some kind of models, but in my opinion, this is the most useful one. And you have to pass both the prediction probability function, and in this case, I have to filter the result by using this lambda function, taking only the one probability, because SHAP it only works by considering one probability, and the base value, that in this case I approximate with the median value. So this base value is used in the generation phase. While Lime is going completely random, SHAP is using, is replacing the attributes using the base value. So you can pass either a unique value like this one here, or a set of values. So an idea could be to run a k-means approach on the data set and pass the centroids as a base value, or all the values in the data set, but this will take time for the explanation process. So I have created the SHAP explainer here in this variable, and then I call the explanation function, that is this one, SHAP values on X, and I specify here that I want to generate 1,000 random samples, and this is a single explanation. So I'm explaining only this specific instance. So we are in the pure local explanation setting. And this is explanation returned by SHAP, expressed by this force plot. So how can we read it? So in bold here, we have the base value, which is 0.50. And in this case, for this specific instance, we have that the predicted value corresponds with the base value. But we can see which are the features pushing towards one rather than another one classification. So those on the left, highlighted in red or purple, are pushing for the classification for augmenting the probability of the outcome. To be precise here, I should have done this. Okay. Because the outcome is zero. Yes, this is the correct answer. So we have marital status, married, relationship, husband, age 34, etc., which are pushing the classification toward the lower class. It means lower than 50K, while native country, United States, equals to zero. It means it's not from United States, is pushing higher. And we can see that the larger is this bar, the most important is the negative contribution. We can see that in this case, Schaap and Lime are not very much in agreement, because while Lime is giving the highest importance to capital gain is not appearing in the most important feature. And while marital status married is the second one, while here is the first one, is the most important one. Then we have husband and age in different orders. Okay, then there is also a way to extract these values. Should be this one, if I'm not wrong, if you want direct, no, it's not this, this one. If you want direct access to these values, should be the Schaap values single. This should be the value of the various Schaeppli values calculated. But with Schaap, you can do many local explanations at the same time. So for instance, here I'm explaining the first 100 instances in the test set, and you can plot the result with this force plot, which is not single, but is for all the values. And this time you have to read it in vertical. I'm not wasting time on it. A better visualization perhaps is this summary plot that basically lists to you all the features. So this time, this one has to be rerun because I changed the function. Okay, majority of blue, okay. And every dot is a point classified. On the x-axis, you have the Schaap value, and the color indicates if the contribution is if the value of the feature is positive, is high or low, sorry. So it's not easy to read again, but for instance, I can read from this that marital status is the most important attribute for these 100 instances, forgetting the classification. Most of them have low values, means this is equal to zero. A few of them having negative contribution, so pushing the class towards higher than 50K, have a high value, that is one, because this is a categorical class. So finally, this is Lore. Lore is not directly installable using pip of conda yet, because we are still refining. However, this package is available on the Sobig Data platform. It works like the previous one. It requires more parameters because it can deal with continuous attributes, categorical attributes, etc. So it reads the knowledge, that is the test set in the original setting, takes the black box prediction function, feature names, class names, and whatever, allows to use different type of neighborhood generation. This is the genetic using probabilities is the default one, but you can also type random and it will work like Lime. We are using a random neighborhood generation, can estimate the the continuous variables for a better approximation instead of assuming a Gaussian distribution. It takes some sec more. Then you can specify the number of generation. The predict proba function is required when you use the probability. And you call it like the others. So explain instance of X, number of samples to generate in the neighborhood 100. It uses a weighted construction of the decision tree like LIME. And it uses, in this case, a normalized Euclidean function to account also for the categorical variables. I enabled verbose true in this case to show you the neighborhood generation genetic passing towards the 10 generations required, optimizing a fitness function that aims at finding closest instances with the same label and closest instances with a different label. In the end, is able to generate a neighborhood with 934 instances of the class minus 50k and 266 instances with the class greater than 50k. And this is the explanation returned. Again, this is an encoding we developed. So this is the rule. So since native country is Iran, age is between 28 and 38, capital gain lower than 4,621, education is not high school, native country is not United States, marital status is not never married, education is not college, education is not prof school, relationship is not unmarried, then the classification is lower than 50k. The counterfactual deltas, in this case, the change you have to do to the instance to get a different outcome are the following. If you set native country as United States, maintaining the same attributes, then you get class higher than 50k. Or if you set education prof school. In our case, education was education. Education is bachelor's. Okay. So an higher level of education. So here we have the classification for X. Then in this case, we make a copy of X named X prime, and we change the education from not some college, but bachelor. Hoping I wrote it correctly. And we set to be prof school equals to one. Bachelor, I misspelled it, so I'm going to copy. Bachelors. Thanks. Okay, and now, as you can see, the explanation for X1 changed indeed. So we got a valid counterfactual rule and a valid counterfactual instance, and we got greater than 50k. Then here in the remaining of this notebook, we re-explained X1 to check that indeed the rule is containing the same aspect in the reverse way, just with the only difference with prof education. But this time you can see that for passing from higher than 50k to lower than 50k, we have more options and classes that we can change. So that's it from my side. So if there are questions regarding the practical part or the theoretical part or the material, I'm available.
So thank you, Ricardo. If there are some questions, please write them into the chat so we can see it.
Maybe I can't see the questions if I'm in sharing window. Okay, now I can see. This is a great question, Andrea. Okay. There are various evaluation measures. This is actually another topic we are studying recently in our group, that is the one of evaluation of different explanations. So for sure, to be certain that an explanation is better than another one, the test, okay, Lorenzo, sorry, because I read Andrea Passarella. Is to perform an experiment involving humans where you provide the explanations coming from different explainers, and you ask these humans to assess a task by using this explanation. And the best explanation is the one better enabling humans to assess the task. But since, let's say, it's not easy to build this kind of test, experiments not involving humans requires quantitative evaluation measures. So one aspect that is generally tested is the so-called fidelity. That is the degree of approximation that the local model from which the explanation is extracted has with the black box. So how good is the local surrogate, as is called, in approximating the behavior of the black box? And the higher is the fidelity, the more you can trust, let's say, the classifier. Another thing that is generally observed is the robustness. So similar instances should have similar explanations, or if you perform ad hoc random perturbation to a certain instance, you should still observe the same explanation. And this is another way to assess it. But let's say in general, I won't say that there is an explainer that is giving to you exactly the reasons for the classification. So maybe a good way of proceeding is to use more of them and then derive a final explanation from a sort of ensemble of explanations. Okay, I've processed the two questions. Anyway, you can also contact me by mail and we can discuss privately if you have some curiosity that maybe needs a longer discussion than simple questions asked here. Okay. If there are no further questions, I think we can end here. Francesco, what do you think?
Francesco has been disconnected.
Okay.
I don't know how, why, but okay, there are no questions. Thank you all for joining. And
thank you for inviting me.
See you at the next webinar.
Yep.